everyone. Hello. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you're joining us from. Welcome to Engineering for Change, or E4C for short. Today, we're very pleased to bring you the latest E4C's 2016 webinar series on the topic of scaling social business at the best base of the pyramid. My name is Mariela Machado, and I'm the program manager here at E4C. I will be the moderator for today's webinar. So welcome, everyone. I would like to take a minute now to tell you a bit more about today's webinar. Social entrepreneurs are concerned with solving urgent social challenges by applying business techniques and private sector approaches. To scale effectively, social business must identify and understand potential challenges to devise strategies to overcome them. The Antenna Foundation has worked for 25 years with numerous social enterprises at every stage of social business development and gathered a variety of lessons learned. So we've invited Gregoire Castella, Deputy Director, and Jerome Voila, Safe Water Programs Coordinator at the Antenna Foundation, along with Joel Jandu, the co-founder of the social business called African Solid Generation, to share their insights. Welcome to all of you, and thank you for joining us today. Before we start, I would like to thank the E4C webinar series team as well. If anybody out there has questions about the series or would like to make a recommendation of future topics and speakers, we invite you to contact the team via the email address visible on the slide, webinars@engineeringforchange.org. The webinar you're participating in today is part of E4C's professional development offerings, information on upcoming webinars in the series, as well as archived videos of past presentations can be found on the E4C webinars webpage. If you're following us on Twitter, I will also like you to invite to join the conversation with our dedicated hashtag, E4C webinars, as shown in the slide. Before we move on to our presenters, I would like to tell you a bit more about Engineering for Change. E4C is a knowledge hub and global community of over 1 million engineers, designers, development practitioners, and social scientists leveraging technology to solve quality of life challenges faced by underserved communities, including access to clean water and sanitation, sustainable energy, improved agriculture, and more. We invite you to join E4C by becoming a member. E4C membership provides cost-free access to relevant and current news, professional development resources, opportunities such as jobs and fellowships, and a growing database of hundreds of essential technologies in our solutions library. E4C members enjoy a unique user experience based on their site behavior and engagement. Essentially, the more you interact with the E4C site, the better we will be able to serve your resources aligned to your interests. We invite you to join E4C's passionate global community and contribute to making people's lives better across the world. Check out our website, engineeringforchange.org, to learn more and sign up. We also invite you to join our next webinar on Thursday, October 13 at the same hour, 11 a.m., on the topic of the role of small wind in rural electrification. We'll be joined by representatives of the Low Carbon Energy for Development Network and Wind Empowerment Association. Check out the professional E4C professional development page for more information and registration details. If you're already on E4C, an E4C member, we'll be sending you an invitation to the webinars directly. So a few housekeeping items before we get started. Let's see first where everyone is from. So in the chat window, which is located at the bottom right of your screen, please type your location. So I start by typing my location. Can everybody see that? I see Oklahoma, New Jersey. We have only U.S. attendees, it seems. Oh, no, Cyprus, Minneapolis. Wow, Cyprus, Canada. Portugal, welcome. Everyone, welcome. So if the chat doesn't open on your screen, you can access it by clicking the chat icon on the top right corner of your screen where it says chat. Any technical questions or administrative questions, feel free to send a private chat to Engineering for Change admin if you have any issues. You can also use the chat window to type any remarks you may have. And during the webinar, please use the Q&A window located below the chat to type in your questions for the presenter. Again, if you don't see this, you can access it by clicking the Q&A icon on the top right corner. If you're listening to the audio broadcast and you encounter any troubles, try hitting stop and then start. You may also want to try opening WebEx up in a different browser. following the webinar to request a certificate of completion showing one professional development hour for this session, please follow the instructions on the top of E4C professional development page. So let's get started, everyone. So it is my pleasure now to introduce our speakers. We'll be joined by Gregoire Costella, which will be speaking first. Gregoire completed his PhD in life sciences in 2008. Greg got out of the lab and joined the International Committee of the Red Cross. He served in the field as delegate and manager in Central Africa Republic, in Ivory Coast, Afghanistan, and Colombia. After returning to Switzerland, Greg joined Antenna, an innovation for development foundation, which has successfully brought to the market innovative products to meet the basic needs of people living at the base of the pyramid. As deputy director, he's managing two projects in the field of energy and safe water, which he will be talking to us about today. We'll be also joined by Joel Jean-Lou, and I hope I said your last name right, Joel. Joel studied international affairs at the University of Saint-Gallen in Switzerland in 2013. He traveled to Cameroon for several months, where he wrote his master thesis on social business at the base of the pyramid. After his return, Joel launched, together with different organizations, a project to promote solar energy in developing countries. The core of the project was the development of a leasing and distribution system for portable solar kits. Today, it has successfully been transformed into the social business Olux. Joel also co-founded the local company African Solar Generation down there, installing smaller and bigger photovoltaic systems. Joel Jean-Lou has already worked in different African countries where he helped launching solar companies, which he will be sharing today with us about those companies. And finally, but not least, Jerome Voila. After studying international business in France, Jerome worked in various positions at large private companies before getting fully involved in the nonprofit sector in 2008. He was first appointed as project manager for a rural development initiative in Cameroon and then as coordinator for a civil society program in Laos. Back to Europe, Jerome managed a European Union cooperation program in Africa. He then joined Antenna in 2015, where he worked for the Water and Hygiene Department. Responsible for a portfolio of water and sanitation projects, he's also in charge of business and training strategies for the water technology. Without anything else to add, I just will pass the mic to our first presenter, Gregoire.
Hey everybody, thanks a lot, Mariela, for the introduction, and thanks a lot also to Engineer for Change for the opportunity to present Antenna and our work in the field of social businesses at the base of the pyramid. So I'm very happy to be with you today or tonight. As Mariela explained already, I'm the deputy director of Antenna Foundation, and as the deputy director, I'm supervising mainly two fields or departments, which are access to energy and access to safe water and hygiene. So first, a few words about Antenna Foundation. So we are 25 years old. We are based in Geneva, and what we are actually is an incubator for bottom of the pyramid technologies. We try to find innovative solutions to answer the needs of people living in poverty. Before going further, I'd like to show you a short 3-minute video about Antenna Foundation. So everybody, I will share the link to our video in the chat. Okay, so sorry about that. So now I just sent on the chat the link about Antenna Foundation. So what I would propose is that I invite everybody to have a look to the video after the webinar, and I will keep on speaking about Antenna Foundation. So what Antenna is doing is that we work actually in three different steps that are explained in the short video. The first step is scientific research. So we do try to find innovative solutions, mainly technical solutions, in order to answer basic needs of people living in poverty. This innovation process is mainly done together with the universities and technical schools, mainly in Switzerland. Then we field test the innovation, and then the last part is dissemination. What I want to say here is that autonomy is really at the center of our approach. the whole process has as a final aim to build a sustainable solution that will favor autonomy of the populations and communities. Also, what I'd like to say is that our approaches are adapted to the technologies and to the various contexts in which we work. So about the science and scientific research. So we develop technological and health and commercial innovative solution. In order to do that, we partner with the universities, non-profit organizations, and private companies. The objective is always to meet the basic needs of marginalized populations in developing countries. Then regarding field testing. So we test our technologies with our various field partners in Africa and in Asia. The idea here is first to make sure that our technology is actually adapted to the customer needs and also to the field conditions. We develop affordable, user-friendly, and smart solution. Our field test is also the opportunity to sometimes test new application to our technologies. This part of field testing is also the opportunity for us to test business models that will allow our solutions to be sustainable. I would like to invite our listener to check a very interesting report called Beyond the Pioneers by Deloitte. It's actually a conceptual paper, very interesting, about the different steps you need in order to scale up a business model for the bottom of the pyramid. With the four steps identified in this report is the first step is blueprint, so make your plan, then validate your plans, then prepare for scale up, and then scaling up. So that's the various steps we follow in order to test our business models. We always work with the local entrepreneur, and we try to allow them to create income generating activities. Now about disseminations. So in order to disseminate our solutions, we have different approaches. We partner with the international organizations, with foundations, and with local NGOs. We do also have some partnerships with government and ministries, for example with the Ministry of Health or Ministry of Education, and then we do also partner with the private sector, with for example with CSR programs. In order to launch social enterprises, we worked with entrepreneur, and we provide also in some cases microfinance. We do for some of our technologies also some technology transfer under certain conditions. Just one word about BOP market. So just the concept of BOP is that there is a vast majority of the population that lives according to different estimates. There's about 3 billion people living with less than $5 a day. Our approach is actually to some part of these people living at the base of the pyramid to develop products and services that are fitted to their needs. Actually, many of the services we do use in developed countries are not adequate for people living at the base of the pyramid. So what we try to do is develop services and products that are adapted to their needs. Something that is important is to understand also those people. They actually have resources, and in order to build a sustainable solution, we use a market-like approach in order to offer them adequate products and services. With this approach, we cannot target the very poor, which will keep on depending on philanthropy or humanitarian aid. We know that, but we target those people maybe living with between $1 to $5 dollars a day. Those two approaches, like social business for the bottom of the pyramid and humanitarian aid, are actually complementary. Just now, after the two presentations, after you will have Jérôme and Joël who will talk to you about energy and water. So I will just say a few words about other activities of the foundation. So we have six departments. One nutrition department where we work with spirulina. Spirulina is a microalgae that is used in order to fight against malnutrition. So we developed methodology in order to build spirulina farms in developing countries. And then we have different business models. Usually part of the production of spirulina is sold in order to sponsor another percentage of the production that is distributed either to orphanage, schools, or hospitals. So that's spirulina farms. Then we have agriculture department. Actually, we have a large spin-off of the foundation, which is called Elephant Vert. You can find more information on elephantvert.com. Elephant Vert is producing and marketing biofertilizer and biopesticides. They're based in Morocco, and they're distributing their products in Western Africa and in France. The idea here, it's a private limited company, but mission-driven company. The idea here is to protect the soils and to offer an alternative to small farmers an alternative and cut their dependency on large agro chemo companies. So that's about agriculture. More information on elephantvert.com. And finally, just one word about our natural med department. So here we develop and validate local health solutions on different topics like the fight against malaria, diabetes, or also high blood pressure. The idea here is always to rely on local resources to validate it and then to disseminate. One last slide about where we are actually present. So Antenna is present in more than 20 countries. As you can see on the map, mainly in Africa. So we have projects in Western Africa, in Guinea-Conakry, in Burkina Faso, in Togo, in Mali, also in Central Africa, in DRC, in Rwanda, Central African Republic, and in Asia, mainly in Pakistan, India, Nepal, Bangladesh, and Cambodia. So that will be it for me. Thanks a lot for the opportunity, and I will leave the ground to my colleague Joël.
So hello everybody. Thank you very much, Grégoire, for the introduction. Thank you very much, Mariella, for presenting us. My name is Joël Chano, and I studied international affairs and governance. And for 2 years in Brooklyn, I was an entrepreneur in Cameroon, where I built a solar company together with Cameroonian Swiss business partner. The company is called African Solar Generation. Besides, I'm working for the energy department of the Antenna Foundation, like Grégoire already told you, where we establish a leading and distribution system for our solar power kit called Olux. We are working in Cameroon with Olux, but also in other African countries such as Kenya or Uganda. So you see, I'm wearing two hats, and I will talk about both, about my personal experience with like really working on the ground. So today I want to give you insights into our activity, especially I want to highlight some challenges we are facing trying to scale up those businesses. So the first company is called Olux, like I said at the very beginning. It's a limited company founded in 2015. We are manufacturing solar power kits and we have our own pay-as-you-go system. Olux was transformed from a project of the Antenna Foundation into a social business. So the foundation is the main shareholder. The other one is African Solar Generation. It's a Cameroonian company founded in 2014, selling Olux kits. So we are ASG is an official partner of the Antenna Foundation in Cameroon, but we are also selling a solar home system, small solar power plants. We have right now 7 employees. So when talking of social business, is there a market for solar energy in Africa? And by looking at the next slide, you would probably say yes. By just looking at this world map, we see that many African countries remain in the dark. According to the World Bank, there are 600 million people without access to electricity, and this market will even grow because grid expansion is not able to keep pace with the population growth. So there is a huge market. Moreover, solar energy comes with a lot of advantages. It's cleaner, it's cheaper, it's less harmful, and so on. So the right question to ask is, why is this market not exploding? I mean, we have the technology, solar energy is not under rocket science, and it's not expensive as costs dropped heavily in the last years. So the sector tells us two things about the main challenges of promoting solar energy in Africa. Firstly, it's affordability. People cannot afford to buy those solar power kits upfront or the bigger installations upfront. And secondly, it's availability, as people do not have access to it. So how do we tackle those problems with the Orux and with ASG? To make our product affordable, we developed our own pay-as-you-go technology. How does it work? So our local partner, which is, for example, ASG in Cameroon, identifies local retailers and supplies them with solar kits. The retailers, they get a smartphone with our app installed. And people living in the village can go to these retailers, make a down payment, and they receive this solar power kit. The retailer programs the power box and unlocks the kit for a certain time with his smartphone. When the payment period expires, the customer has to go back to the retailer until he owns the kit. The local partner is able to fully control the smartphone and is having access to it. Because the information from the smartphone, that's very important to know, are sent to our servers regularly, and the local partner has access to a web portal. So he knows exactly, the local partner, which is, for example, ASG in Cameroon, knows exactly how the retailers in the field, how they perform. So this system allows, at the end, the customer to pay progressively. So a customer can invest his money, his monthly energy spending into the purchase of kits. How is ASG working? So ASG is solving the problem of last mile distribution by being present in local communities, which means you see it on the map of Cameroon that we are working in the capital city of Yaoundé, but we also work in remote parts which are even far away. So our employees are well connected in the communities, that's very important. And so they can easily find all of the retailers, or they can even identify customers who want to buy our solar installations. On the right, you see one of our customers who bought a small solar home system so that he has light and he can run a TV. So far, so good. This is more like theory, what the sector tells us, and like describing the main challenges. But it's a little bit more than that, and that's why we're going now from theory to practice. Because this sounds very logical, and with this approach I just presented you, you might think that it's easy to tackle the problems of affordability and availability. However, it's a little bit more complicated, and I will give you some insights from our company, ASG, and from the off-grid market in Cameroon in general. So just be aware that this is like very based on my own experience in Cameroon. So people are very interested, but we realize when we're talking to customers on the field that people prefer to spend less money on something that is of poor quality than on something that is of good quality, but comes at a higher price. No matter if they have to spend it again and again. So they, for example, prefer to buy a cheap phone, although they have to buy another one in 2 months, instead of buying every 2 years a good one. That's what I call this very, very short-term thinking. Another problem is that the solar energy is rather an investment than a consumer good. So I give you a good example. One of our customers bought an installation because he needed light for his little shop. A little bit later, he bought a printer to make copies. Another customer started to sell food and drinks because he was the only one in the whole region with TV. But this also counts for private households when they buy an old solar power kit, for example. It's quite an investment, but it pays you off easily. So on the right, on the picture, You see a customer with an Olux kit in his shop, charge mobile phones, and he gets paid for that. So he's actually earning money with having better light in his shop. He's used to it behavior. People in off-grid areas live their whole life without having access to electricity. They are used to it and they don't need it urgently. It's a little bit the same with us. Today, nobody can imagine a life without a smartphone, but I think that our childhood was quite good. And this is the same is true when you did not have anything like the Ola. That's what I call the used to it behavior. Mistrust among people. Last year, give you just a very good example. Last year at the off-grid lighting conference, for example, a man told us about fake solar panels. Some swindlers made copies of solar panels and they put them in a frame and sold it. So you see, people are afraid of such things, and also understand why people have that trust issues. Marketing is very time consuming. As you see on the next picture, you can easily spend a whole day, a whole afternoon explaining the product to the people living in the village. So this village meeting you see on this picture there, you see also in the back, there is a solar panel, and we try to explain to people what are the advantages of our solar power kit and why it absolutely makes sense to buy it. Another problem when building up a company in Cameroon, what we realized is that it's very hard to building up a local team. So it's very hard to find skilled, reliable, trustful people. And so, for example, within 2 years, we had to fire two of our technical directors because of fraud. So even we paid quite a good salary, they were trying to steal money, and that is still a huge problem, that we cannot easily trust people, but you have to trust people, otherwise you're not able to scale up. Mistrust among team members. We actually face the problem that our employees, they don't want to share their skills because they are afraid of being replaced. So this makes it very hard to work as a team and to grow as a team. The top-down pattern, which is also a little bit a broader problem of the Cameroonian education system. A friend of mine, for example, he made a movie about the education system in Cameroon. So he told me many stories about how teachers are working in Cameroon. So for example, we have the economics teacher. He taught economics by reading aloud while the student had to write it down, sentence by sentence. And this, of course, does not stimulate independent critical thinking. And this, at the end, leads to a lack of leadership. And leadership is what you need if you want to grow. Another problem we face on the ground is logistics. As you may see on this picture directly, that is one of our cars. You see how we have to work. And you can imagine that it's not easy. And if you want to be successful, you have to be able to handle logistics. For ASG, we identified logistics as one of the bottlenecks of our company. We work in remote areas far away from the office, and you have to be able to manage these logistics in order to create not to create too many costs and not to make the product too expensive. And it's actually very hard, especially during rainy seasons, and you have to be able to tackle this problem. Because this nature, you cannot change that. The last big problem we have in Cameroon is the complex business environment. And you see on the right, you see scissors. And I will also tell you a story about the scissors. But first, about Cameroon, about corruption in Cameroon. According to Transparency International, Cameroon is one of the most corrupt countries in the world. So although it ranks much better today than a couple of years ago, reality is different. And now about the story of the Siddles. A friend of mine, she opened a school in Cameroon, and she bought in the United States, she bought a huge pair of scissors for the ribbon cutting ceremony, and she paid $120 for the scissors, but they are now stuck at customs because the authorities, they now ask 600 dogs importation tax, so which is 5 times the value. And you see, and with such an environment with such a high corruption, it's very, very complicated to work. We have the non-transparent tax system and custom duties, and of course, the system is not transparent at all. So you don't know in advance how much you pay for importation, for example. So if she would have known before, she would have not ordered this decision. Another problem is strong labor law. You think twice before you employ someone, because it's not easy to fire someone in case of fraud, for example. And the complexity of local structure, so it's often not easy to work in the rural areas, as local authorities always want to be involved. So this often also leads up to corruption, and you have to cooperate with the local authorities, which means you have to give them something. So this was just like giving you some insight about the problem we actually face trying to scale up our business in Cameroon. And people always ask me why I'm doing that, why I'm working in Cameroon. And they ask me, do you really believe you will make it? And to be honest, I'm highly skeptical that we will have success, but I don't doubt one second that there is a chance to make it. And before I had this webinar, some people at the foundation, they told me not to be too negative. And I'm not negative at all, but I'm just saying that what you really have to be is innovative, you have to be creative, and you definitely have to find a new solution. So it's not a question whether the energy market in Cameroon will grow or not, it's just only a question of time. And the problem of time is that you have a lot of running costs, and as an entrepreneur, you don't have time. And you see it very well on this picture, that there's always a way, but you have to find it, and there are a lot of obstacles in the way. So I hope you enjoyed this little insight, and thank you very much for attending this webinar.
Hello, everybody. So my name is Jérôme Voyat, and I'm project manager in the Water and Hygiene Unit of the Antenna Foundation. So after the presentation of Joël talking about Olux technology and the implementation in Cameroon, we'll go to another field example, and I will detail a bit what we do under the Water and Hygiene Department, how we try to make our models sustainable, and I will provide you a couple of details about our technology and the way we work with our local partners. But first of all, I will draw your attention on the global context about water in the world. So on this map, you can clearly identify the regions of the world where there are countries in a water stress situations. So basically, all the countries in yellow and orange are countries where water is a real issue. Access to water or clean water is a real issue in these countries. So basically, and as Greg was saying at the very beginning of the foundation, the Antenna Foundation decided to target this issue by addressing a simple technology for this problem. So basically, working on the water and sanitation issues, we work also in the frame of the Sustainable Development Goals, and especially the number 6, which is related to clean water and sanitation. So I assume the majority of you are aware about these 17 goals. So this is the way given by the United Nations to reach a better standard of living for everyone by 2030. So let's go deeper into what we do Antenna under this Water and Hygiene Department. So we developed a technology which is an electrolysis technology of water and salt that creates, after a certain while, some chlorine. So basically, we have several devices with several sizes which produce chlorine. This chlorine then can be used for safe water purpose and also for disinfection purposes. So I will tell you a bit later about the various applications that we have, but I will tell you still a bit more about the technology and what we propose. Basically, we have this range of products, so going from a very small device to a very large one. So the Mini Wata, the smallest device of the range, produces half a liter of chlorine, so it's much more dedicated to communities in rural areas, for example. And the very large one, so the Maxi Wata, can produce 60 liters of chlorine in 4.5 hours and is more dedicated to chlorine factories or maybe healthcare centers purposes. With these five devices, we also develop two reagents that are respectively able to control the level of chlorine in the solution that has been produced and also the level of residual chlorine in the drinking water. So basically, you can also identify on this range of product that 3 out of 5 are also working on solar energy. So this is not by chance. Actually, we are targeting a lot the rural and remote areas. And that's why we can not only rely on regular energy, and we are trying to adapt on what's available locally. So after this introduction on the technology, I would like to shift to what's really interesting in this webinar. So how a simple technology that is community driven most of the time can be interesting in a project and can be sustainable in time. So I will introduce you 3 field examples. The very first one comes from Africa and from Guinea. So we have a partnership there with a company that is called Tinkiso. So basically, this company is based in a country where cholera epidemics are happening quite often. This is a country also where the Ebola crisis took place. And in this country, actually, we are currently partnering with the local company that is able to produce this chlorine and put it in a flask and sell it to the local market. So basically, the approach that was described by Greg at the very beginning of the presentation is clearly also described in this example. So we provided our support. Now there are more than 5 million bottles that are sold every year, and we feel like this is a local solution for the local market. The second example that I would like to introduce you is maybe more about the sustainability, and it comes from Asia. So we are partnering there with a social business that is called Tara, based in Delhi and active in several provinces in the country. So here, there is also this principle of producing chlorine and putting it in flask. But in Tara, actually, they have this large team that goes directly to the field and that advocate about the necessity, the need of drinking safe water and to treat the water before drinking. So basically, with this example, we are also addressing the issue of social marketing and awareness for communities. With the very last example that takes place also in India with Spring Health, we are also discovering the example of water kiosk. So the example of water kiosk is really interesting for our model, because with this model especially, we can reach what is called the last mile or even sometimes the last meter. So that means reach every single individual to bring a valuable message of drinking safe water. So basically, the very good assets of this approach are the home delivery and the role of promoters in communities that are able to deliver the message and also deliver the product until every single individual. So this is an interesting model this is maybe not the best one because the economic model around that is still always fragile. And you, as a community level, you always have to take care about how sustainable this model is, and you have to rely on a very good price for the service you are providing. So before, I think there is still 15 minutes left, and we, the three of us, we would like to have your questions so that we can directly interact. Before that, actually, I would like to go back to what the foundation is and go back to the six different topics we are working on currently. So as you can see, we are working from the prototype of our technology to the autonomy of a local partner most of the time. So as Greg was explaining at the very beginning, from scientific research to dissemination after field test. And you can see that the different icons of the six different departments where we work are currently at different stages of development. We already succeeded in reaching the status of social business for two of them, agriculture and solar energy, and two others are in transition actually. So the whole cycle is already completed for microcredit and water and hygiene. And we are ready to become a social business for these two ones, which is really interesting. So don't believe there is nothing else coming on the pipe. Actually, we still have other fields in terms of scientific research currently, and we'll keep you posted about the next innovations that Antenna will test and share on the web actually. So this is the very first slide. We would like to thank Engineering for Change for welcoming our presentation. The three of us, we are now ready to answer your questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for the three of you. It was a super interesting presentation. So I want to remind you, everyone, so we'll open it for Q&A. Please use the Q&A window. If you don't see it, it's at the top, so you see participant chat and Q&A, just click Q&A and put your questions there. I would like to start making the first question. So that's for the three of you. You know, you mentioned that the population that you are targeting is $5 or less. I'm wondering, and you mentioned it in a couple of slides, but I want you know, maybe to speak a little more about that. How to make it? How do you make a product sustainable financially if that population is $5 or less? It's the bottom of the pyramid. You mentioned the solar kits, for example. There's some market, but how to make it sustainable financially?
First, one thing that has to be clear, that those people living with less than $5 a day, for example, taking the solar kit example, they do use an important part of their resources in order to have energy. Actually, they pay their energy very high price, with people spending, we did actually some calculations in Cameroon, and selling our kit 80,000 francs CFA, which is a bit more than $100, looking at how much the households usually spend for their energy expenses, our kit will be sold after 8 months, meaning that in 8 months they spend $100 in their energy expenses. So in the end, they will our kit is guaranteed for 2 years. So in the end, they will actually save money from the 8 months, between the eight months and months 24. And we target actually markets that are quite huge, because it's true that resources are scarce for those for the bottom of the pyramid, but it's a pity to say so, but there is a lot of people. So there's ways to make products sustainable, and It's true also that there are other solutions in order to make your product more affordable. That is, for example, blended finance. Blended finance, it's a mix between a market approach and subsidies. So you can also sell your product with smart subsidies in order to make it more affordable. So there's like both approaches, like a real market, pure market-based approach. For some markets and some segment of the markets, and then also some instrument in the field of blended finance and impact investing.
Okay, thank you so much. That's very interesting. So I'm gonna first mention that Antenna posted in the chat the video, so that if you wanna take a look at that. At the video that they were going to show at the beginning, please do so. Also, they're asking for the report that you mentioned, the Deloitte one. If you could share that with everyone in the chat, that would be also great. So I'm going to read here a couple of Q&As, a few of them. So one participant is asking that he's interested in to knowing the value supply chain of the solar panels and how to they maintain an affordable price. A little what you talked about right now, but more focused on the solar panel supply chain.
Okay, so if I can answer this question. I mean, at the moment we are having a price that is subsidized by the Antenna Foundation, because the quantity of producing our solar kit is just not high enough. But of course, I mean, we have to buy all the parts of our solar kit where we find the cheapest price, and that's obviously not in Switzerland, that's not in Europe either for such solar power kits, like for small portable solar kits, that will be in Asia. And it's of course that we, if you want to have even if it's social business, we have to be competitive, which means we have to buy the solar materials where we can get it at the best price.
Okay, great. Thank you for that. There's another question here about Wata. They say that it seems like a great product and it's an interesting way to solve the last mile delivery problem for chlorine. But how do you solve the problem of delivering Wata itself? How do we convince local business or entrepreneurs to buy Wata? And I guess, you know, that's also related to one question I had while you were presenting the distribution methods, right? And how to make it, how to convince people that that's the best way.
So in some countries, actually, where we work, we have actually local partners. And these partners, they are actually the intermediate between Antenna and the beneficiaries in the field. That means that these local partners, we have long-term relationships with them, we have trained them, and they are in a position to use the devices properly, to teach and to train people how to use them and what's the approach associated. And they can also take care and make the link with us for after sale. So basically, this is how we work locally, always taking care that there is a local partner in place.
Okay, thank you so much. Yeah, the importance of the local partners, that was something that you guys mentioned. We have another question here about what percentage of the solar panels are subsidized, and what is its market value? I guess that's from Joel.
Yes. So first of all, I have to, because I'm wearing those two hats, I have also to differ. I mean, the solar installation we sell with ASG, the company ASG in Cameroon, they are not subsidized. The Olux power kit, it's just on the level of production they are subsidized, because the problem is that we are right now not having huge quantities, which means like several 10,000 per year. It's hard for us to reduce the price. So you see, it really depends. But all the Olux kits we sell right now, they are subsidized by the foundation, to in order to have a price that is affordable to people living in rural areas.
Okay, great. And I think that this from the same person, do you get a return from the business you launch, equity stake or repayment?
For example, in Ulm, we just launched a social startup, and the foundation has shares in this startup. The return will be in several years, obviously, because it's a tough market. And the idea here is to support the startup, and in the long term, to have some returns. We also have some partners, for example, in Africa, in Guinea, where we on one side subsidize them, and for other programs, we give them loans without interest rates. So there's different models. Sometimes we have shares, sometimes loan, and sometimes pure subsidies.
And just you're talking about that financial method, so you mentioned and you all did, I think, about using mobiles for repayment. I'm specialized in ICT for development. So how do you use the mobile money in your social enterprise, and more specifically in the solar startup?
So if I got it right, you're talking about mobile payment.
Yes, just to be aware,
mobile payment is really an East African thing. It's not a West and either a Central African thing. I mean, it starts, but it's on a very low level. So for us, we have exactly that problem, that our system is also, we developed it according to the requirements in Cameroon. And in Cameroon, unfortunately, we do not have a lot of mobile money. So still we have this ICT system, this pay-as-you-go system, to allow customers to pay progressively, but still they have to pay cash, and they have to send, the retailers have to send the cash with mobile money services like Western Union, for example. They have to send it to the local office in Yaoundé, in the capital city.
Okay, great. So we have 1 minute. I just wanted to be respectful of everyone's time and just let the last question, and I think you addressed that one, Joel, in the chat, that they're asking if Antenna is open to working with technologies not made in Switzerland.
Yes. So, well, obviously, we're always interested to find out new innovative solutions. Our aim is to find solutions for people, for the basic needs of people living at the bottom of the pyramid. So we are really happy to know more. If somebody wants to share their ideas or their project, we would be very happy to hear about it. I guess you will have at some point our website for sure, but our email address. So please, if you have ideas, project, please get in touch with us.
Okay, great. Is there any email, or it's on the web page? Any specific email, or just like through the web page they can write you?
Yeah, you can find our email addresses in the web page. You go in web page team, and then you can find either Jérôme for water, me generally for the foundation, and Joël for the field of access to energy. And if you have any doubt, send it to info@antenna.ch.
Great. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for attending. This will be recorded and it will be on our webpage. And thank you once more. Don't forget to become an E4C member to get info on upcoming webinars. Thank you.